Okay. Hello, everyone. My name is Nick DeRuyter. I'm the WildSmart Program Director, and I'm here today with Mya Helena Myllykoski. How you doing, Mya?
I'm good. I'm happy. I'm sheltering in BC.
Okay. I'm glad to see that you're doing well and staying healthy. So Mya was actually going to do a presentation for us at Bear Day, which had to be canceled on April 18th. So we're going to do it virtually so that we can still get some of that amazing information and hear her story and some of the lessons learned about a grizzly bear encounter that that Mya and her son Alex had back in August of 2018 in Kananaskis Country. So thank you for joining me today, Mya. And why don't you take it away and tell us about your encounter that happened 2 years ago.
Okay, well, I'll start and tell you a little bit about it. I have to just say at the beginning is that we're very lucky. We had a positive outcome from this experience, and not everybody does. So we do realize how lucky, and we're very grateful that we got some lessons from it, from the bear, rather than some too serious injuries, although we did have a few. I do want to say, though, a little caution is that this slideshow, there is some pictures here that might be triggering or traumatizing for some people. So just to be aware of that and to be forewarned before we go on. So what happened to us? Well, we didn't realize we were uninvited dinner guests to a moose carcass that a grizzly bear was on. And we couldn't have predicted that. And so we ended up encountering a bear. Here's a bit of a gruesome picture. He came out of the forest suddenly, and my son stood up and tried to be big, and we got separated on one or the other side of the trail. I got pushed down, and my son ended up with a bite to the arm and the inner part of his nose. He got an injury to his neck. I got some scratch marks. It was a really big bear. You can see scratch marks on his chest there. Those are 4 out of 5 claws. But he was really had a lot of restraint. We were very, very, he pushed me down. And you know what happened was he bit me. He bit my, he tasted me. I wasn't mauled. I was tasted by a bear. So that lower picture there, my hand, he bit a can in my hand, and my hand swelled up quite a bit. Bit my arm. That's my arm there. I was barely scratched. Little pun there. Uh-huh. And he bit through a can of bear spray, right through the can. That's a picture of the can that I had. And luckily I did have that. I can talk more about that.
So both of you got some minor injuries, but you were able to walk away from the encounter.
Thankfully, we were really lucky. We were not too far from a parking lot. The bear, as soon as he bit that can, and I was holding it, and I was down on the ground, and he bit the can and backed away immediately. And then we gathered up our stuff and hiked out. I was covered with bear spray, and my son had those few injuries there, but he took off. And the interesting thing is when we were standing there kind of gathering our senses there, getting ourselves organized, we heard this big kind of howl in the forest.
Yeah.
And we realized it was the bear that was obviously in pain from that bear spray. Yeah, it was quite an experience.
Based on your experience, what are some of the things people can do to be better prepared for these kind of encounters before they even leave the house and then while they are out hiking?
Yeah, well, there are so many things that we should have done, but some things we did do. I mean, there are lots and lots of guides. Here's a couple. There are so many guides out there. There's some that are stories, like The Revenant, of course, is a story. But I think that's part of prep, is just thinking to yourselves that you're going into a wild area that really humans are very poorly prepared to go into. And this is why we've got all our equipment that we wear and take with us. But there's all kinds of guides out there to seek out information. And Parks Canada has lots of information out online now. We're living more and more in an online world, but anywhere there's parks information, I would stop and read it. So this is a sign that was up near where we were at. It's berry season. Bear encounters are likely, which is really important. I mean, those first two lines are so important. Anticipate it. And there's some little tips there. We prepared by looking at the map of where we were going, and that's where our encounter happened, is just in the valley there between Chester Lake and Burstall Pass.
Okay.
And also to be aware of your surroundings once you're out. Be aware, look around for scat, and have a look at where your trail is going, and then hiking in groups and trying to go out in groups is a better idea than we did, because we were just two of us when we went. And you can see where we went. This is the trail. I took this photo a few moments before the encounter. It's my son there in front of me. We were in this deep, dense undergrowth on either side of the trail. So another thing that we could have done much better is to make our presence known, because we were on this trail. There was no one else on this trail. It was an old road, I think. There was two pathways side by side. And big thing, the biggest thing I can say from this, there's many, but one, if I had to pick one, it would be bear spray on hand for everyone. And that doesn't mean back in the back of your backpack. You can see my son there in front. He didn't have bear spray that day, and that was a mistake. That's my one biggest regret. I did have bear spray. It was on the outside of my pack there, just in one of those side pockets. And I know now it's better to have it attached to your body in front of you so you can get it at any time. That was one thing.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, no, that's great. That's one of those things we try to talk to people about that a lot of times, is that people often ask, like, how many cans of bear spray should we take? But Yes, I think that's a great, great lesson you just gave, that to everyone in the group should be carrying bear spray, because you never know if you get separated.
Oh, yeah. And I'll tell you, that bear spray, wow, that bear spray was so powerful. And as I said, that's a picture of me in the hospital after my eyes swelled up. That bear spray is amazingly effective. It kept all the people away from me too after. they put me into the ambulance bay because I smelled so bad. And it took up about 3 days for me to get all of it off. It's this oily, oily residue from naturally occurring peppers and that, and a propellant. And that spray it got rid of a huge bear. They estimated afterward that he was probably over 600 pound big male grizzly bear, and it got rid of him instantly. Mm-hmm. And I'll tell you, that stuff burns, and it's really, really effective. I'm so glad I had that one can. What more can I say? I mean, yeah, that bear spray saved me. And myself. Yeah,
you would say that, would you say it was the bear spray that ended the encounter?
Oh, for sure. The bear spray ended that encounter instantaneously. It saved, you know, and I'm so grateful. Obviously, it saved my life. It saved my son's life. But it also saved that bear's life. Because for me, I love the wilds. And had that bear, you know, injured us badly, much worse. If I hadn't had that bear spray, let's say we survived with worse injuries, they might have taken that bear's life too. And I love bears. So I've named that bear Flower. And you know what? Flower saved my life, my son's life, and his own life that day through my can of bear spray, by biting that can of bear spray.
Yeah. And can you just go to the previous slide 1 second? I just want to make sure everyone understands that. It was the one with the big hole. So the bear actually bit your hand and the can of bear spray, correct? And it sprayed itself in the face through the puncture hole that it made in the can, correct?
Yeah, like look at that. He bit right through that can. You can see right through the can. That was a large can of bear spray. And you know what I should say too about bear spray, Nick, is that I felt really, at the time of the attack, I thought to myself, I'm such a dummy. I haven't practiced, because I had practiced years before. But it's not just getting the can, it's looking at it, kind of thinking in your mind, okay, I pull off this tab or whatever brand you've got, and this is what I'm going to do so you kind of mentally prepare in your mind. And I hadn't done that. So that went through my mind at the time. So when he was on top of me biting that can, I thought, gee, I haven't practiced this. That's what went through my mind.
Yeah, no, that's a very good point. That's exactly why we do bear spray training with outdoor ed students, different staff from local businesses, visitors, residents. That's very important for people to practice and even in your mind think about, how am I going to do this? How am I going to get my bear spray out? And that's why it's key to have it in an easily accessible location, because when you need it, like you guys, you might need it within 2 or 3 seconds, so you don't have time to fumble around and try to find it. So having it on your person, yeah, that's a very, very important, very good point.
Yeah, and you can make your own. You don't have to buy some fancy holster. You can make your own holster out of just a simple bag that's right in front of your body. It's tied to your body, your waist, so it's right on hand. Really important. Really
important. Very good point. One quick question I had about the bear spray. So your eyes were stinging and stuff. How long did that last?
Oh gosh, my eyes here. That was stinging for days.
Days,
What happened was it exploded in my face and the bear's face. So I tried to get that off with the shower. That's my head in the towel in the ambulance bay. And it took about 3 days of twice a day showering to get that oily stuff off of my face and my body, because it ran all over my, once I poured water on my head, that was a silly thing to do at the time because it just spread it all over. Very painful stuff, really effective.
But obviously, yeah, it's temporary, it's not permanent.
No.
And so it helped save your lives and also a bear's life. So that's a...
Absolutely.
What are some of the important lessons that you've taken away from this encounter?
Okay, well, I think I got some slides on that. I got here my little presentation here I was going to do. We are all part of a bigger community, right? And so the biggest lesson I learned is about being, we're all here for bears, for people, and for the environment. We need to be aware of what's going on around us. And aside from the benefits of having bear spray, there's so much that we can do just to be part of a bigger environment. So being prepared, being part of the community, look for information such as when closures are enacted, prepare yourself to keep bears and people safe. If you really love the wild and respect animals and nature, well, follow the guidelines and advice of experts. You don't need to go and read one of those big books. There's pamphlets and information everywhere, so prepare beforehand. We got some gifts from Flower, I always say. Be bear smart, carry bear spray, wear it appropriately. Let's see here. Here's my list. The lessons learned. Don't rely on luck. Don't think this can't happen to you. Not that I ever really thought that, because I always thought it could happen to me. And so thankfully I had the one can of bear spray. Prepare before you leave. So before you leave. So mentally prepare. Think about, anticipate a bear. Of course, have your appropriate clothing and fitness. I'm not sure I had the fitness there. Fitness is a really good idea when you're wrestling a bear. I'm still working on fitness.
So am I.
Yeah. Bear spray for all hikers. I didn't look for that second bear of bear spray that morning. So my son Alex didn't have a can. And that, like I said, was my biggest regret. Secure it to your body. Know your area. Keep up to date with alerts. Practice. Travel in groups. So we were just, if you can, we were just two of us. But the experts tell us that bear encounters are really rare for groups of four and up, or three and up at least. Make your presence known. You know, like think about caring. They always say bears' bells are effective, but that's talking out loud. If you see presence of bear scat, make sure you're talking. Keep talking to your hiking partners. And I know this might be a little controversial because I have two dogs and, oh, I love my dogs so much. But, you know, maybe leave your dogs at home. I left my dogs at home that day, and I'm very glad. I always do. But, you know, had my two dogs been with me that day, I think we all would have been gone. I know I have little dogs and they would have gone ballistic and barking and probably agitated that bear even more. Did I mention carry bear spray?
I think you mentioned I think you did mention that, yes.
And all those things, all those things are about respecting the wild for being the wild. And really, it's about protecting ourselves, well, and the bears. But all of those things are really about being, you know, part of a wild community. There's always signs of bear activity around in areas. So that's scat, poop, bear poop. Sometimes it'll be digging, you'll see, and sometimes on the trails in the Kananaskis area, I've seen evidence of digging and rooting behavior. You might even see tracks or chewed or clawed trees. That's bear activity. Be aware of that and maybe stay away. Look around, stay together as hikers. Now, you might want to say a bit more about this later, but what I learned, and I am no bear expert, I'm just a hiker. If you surprise a bear and you're charged, just know you cannot escape a bear. Now, we'll talk about this a little bit more, but some experts talk about lying down or playing dead. All I know is that for us, I can say that you can't predict everything. You cannot predict every eventuality. For us, our bear was well-fed. He was really restrained, probably because he was so well-fed. He was leaving a carcass as opposed to going to it. There's so many things we couldn't have predicted. So I do know that my son standing up probably wasn't a great idea, because he went for my son and he left me alone when I laid down. As soon as I moved, he came after me with my bear spray. So the other thing I learned, and I've learned this a long time ago, is that when bears kind of play fight or actual fight other bears, they go for the head. So I think that's where that advice comes from the experts, is cover your head and neck, because they'll go for your head and neck. Sometimes the experts have said you might be bluff charged. You know, it might be further away. Our bear was only about, I'm going to guess, 3 meters from us when he came through the forest. So we had no chance to back away. He was just meters from us when he came. If you're far away, far enough away, and you're bluff charged, and they're sort of telling you to go away, back away. Sometimes experts have said, speak in a low tone. Don't make eye contact. Pardon me. Slowly back away if you can and leave the area. It's really rare for bears, as far as I know, for them to be predacious, meaning that they're hunting you. They're usually defending their cubs or their space, their area, or in our case, their meal. So I learned about that too on that day. Running away, just like for some dogs, can trigger an attack. You can't outrun a bear. Usain Bolt cannot outrun a bear.
Very true.
Yeah. The other thing is expect to see a bear and anticipate your plan of action. So I said that at the beginning, but really talk with your hiking partners and say, I'm going to be in front, you, the kids in between, so-and-so will be in the back. And another thing, don't attract bears with garbage or food or waste. I've seen people throw stuff, and you know what? I can confess, I have thrown a piece of granola bar out of my car when I was driving. Isn't that awful? I confess I've done that. I know now, though, really bad idea, because when you put stuff on the trail or you throw it out of your car, you're attracting bears and other wildlife to eat that stuff. They've got a great sense of smell, pardon me, and they can they're going to come to that. And I love bears. I want to save more bears. So make sure that when you come out, the bear wouldn't even know that you were there. And lastly, to report all bear encounters, because they, you know, our wildlife officials, our conservation officers, and experts on bears, they want to know what's going on with our bear Canadians out there, our bears out in the forest. We can protect more bears that way.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah, that's very good. And for those in the Bow Valley and Kananaskis Country, that number is 403-591-7755. So that's a number that everyone should have in their phones or easily accessible to report. Looking back, what are some of the things, just really quickly, like what are some of the things you did correctly during your encounter?
Right. So what I did correctly is I had one can of bear spray. That was the big correct thing. We had, I read about the route. I knew exactly the route we were going. We did read all the signs prior. Alex read a sign when we were going in there that there had been a bear in the area. We dressed appropriately, and Alex was fit. I wasn't as fit. But my son, who was 24 at the time, was fit. And we did some good things. We stayed mostly together. I did look at scat. I was talking to my son about scat just before. I didn't really heed that warning because it was a fresh pile of scat. There's lots I could have done better. And of course, I'll go right back to that bear spray. So Alex should have had his bear spray. I should have had it on my body. I think we should have paid more attention to that fresh pile of scat that I saw. We should have been making more noise because at the time of this encounter, when he came out a few meters from us, we weren't speaking. We weren't talking. We were just hiking along side by side quietly. And we should have been making a little bit more noise, talking to each other. That would have been better. And I mean, again, as I said before, you can't predict every encounter, but I think that if Alex had turtled down, he would have had less injury. And if I had had my can of bear spray out and ready, that would have been much better. I mean, both of us having that bear spray for sure. And I think, you know, what we did afterward is we left and we reported it right away, and we mostly recovered. Mentally, we were mentally well prepared, and nothing happened to us that way as a result of it. And I think sharing the story with other people is something I'm really passionate about, because I want us all to enjoy the beautiful beautiful wilds that we have, and to protect our wonderful bears.
That's a great point, because you know, like I try to educate people all the time, but I personally have never been in a bear attack or bear encounter. So it's nice to hear these things from someone who actually has been in an encounter like yours. I think it holds a little bit more weight and makes, you know, makes people really think about, you know, and I really like people to think about that whole, like, oh, it couldn't happen to me, but yes, it could happen to any of us if we're out in bear country.
Yeah.
So has your experience made you afraid of bears or going hiking and being outdoors?
Oh, great question. No, actually I feel more prepared. I've thought it through much better. I because of this, I'm trying to talk a little bit about our experience. Again, I'm so grateful that we came out of this relatively unscathed. And no, I'm not. I think that I could probably handle things a bit better next time. I don't want to ever encounter a bear again, that's for sure. I want to see him from a kilometer or two away or on a movie. I don't want to encounter another bear, but I'm not more afraid. I'm more prepared now. Yeah.
The question that I get asked all the time during my presentations, I often get asked about the different types of encounters. You've got the defensive encounter, the non-defensive, sometimes called the predatory encounter. And people ask me about playing dead and fighting back and all those things. And one of my first answers always is, you know, that can be fairly complicated because you don't always know what the bear is thinking or what exactly is happening, which is why I recommend carrying bear spray, because regardless of the encounter, if a bear comes within range of your bear spray and you feel threatened, you pull out your bear spray and use it. So it kind of takes the guesswork out of it. But, you know, that the bear spray piece aside, so your encounter was a pretty classic defensive encounter where you interrupted the bear's dinner. Mm-hmm. A nice moose meal. So yeah, those defensive encounters where they're feeding, you're interrupting them feeding, whether it's a carcass or them eating berries, or they're protecting their cubs, or you surprise them. In those classic defensive encounters, we're perceived as a threat to the bear. So that's why you know, experts say and talk about playing dead so you're no longer a threat. And you mentioned how Alex standing up, and then the bear came to him, and that when you started moving and standing up, that the bear turned its focus to you as well. So in those scenarios, as the experts say, they talk about playing dead. Do you think realistically, if you got into one of these encounters again, a defensive encounter, do you think in all honesty, you would be able to make yourself play dead? Do you think you could actually do that?
Yeah, good question. I couldn't predict as much because as you said, there's so many variables, like is the bear really well fed or not, all those things. I think I could. I do think I could. I know two things. I know that I can survive it, but I also know that I might not survive it. You know, you can't predict everything. I think what I do know is the best chance that I might have in a defensive encounter is turtling down, protecting my head. It's going to go, bears do this, you know, in the wild, they go for it and they go, to each other. And so they go to your face too. And that's what happened to my son. It went straight for his face and, you know, damaged his face a little bit. So I think that I could. I don't know what would happen. I can't predict. Mm-hmm. But I do know it's my best chance. Really, yep. It's my best chance. After the bear spray, turtling down is my yep. best chance. But again, I can't predict everything. I think I could do it, especially now that I've been through it and I've mentally thought through beforehand now. I've thought it through and I've talked to my son and we've been hiking since then, soon after then. A week later, we went yep. hiking. And
wow, a week later. That's impressive.
And I went with my younger son, who is only 12. And I talked to him and I said, you know what happened? I told him the story and I said, what we're going to do. And we planned it out. If this happens, you're going to turtle down. I'm going to have my spray. You'll have your spray. And that, and we sort of mentally thought it through, but we can't predict everything. Yep. So I guess I don't have a real answer other than mental prep, thinking it through, do your best chance.
Yeah. It's a question I get asked all the time and people are like, do you really expect me to just lay there and do nothing? But obviously that is what works. But it's a lot to ask of people, and that's why that carrying that bear spray is
well, you know what, Nick?
Because then it takes that guesswork out of it.
Yeah, and you know what, Nick, though? Is the bear, when it bear, like it left me alone when I was on the ground. It didn't even talk to me. It was when I started moving and it came after me, and that was the claw marks on my chest, is he pushed me down. Yeah. And it was like telling me down yeah. on the ground. And yeah. And that's where I'm not threatening. So the bear yeah. actually answered that question and said, you're yeah. down on the ground. Yeah. Yeah. And I know I was on my back. And so my face was exposed. So I would have turned myself over, I think, were able to plan it all out. And I did not plan anything in this one.
Yeah. And that's a good one, just to know what position to go when, you know, laying on your stomach, hands laced behind your neck, legs yep. spread apart so they can't roll you over. Yeah, so those are great things that people can practice at home beforehand so you know what to do. But good to hear also that, in those defensive encounters, if we're perceived as a threat, if we lay there on the ground motionless and play dead, we're no longer a threat and they'll leave us alone. And when we start moving and getting up and trying to run away or scream or shout, that's when they're like, hey, stay. I told you to stay. Get back down. And that's what the bear did to you.
Yeah, and, you know, again, I know that there's been people who have saved themselves climbing trees and stuff. I can't predict everything, but if you were in my situation, turtling down would have been the best thing. And I don't know, I guess I'll hopefully never see a bear again, but if I went through the same thing again, if I had to do it next week, that's what I would do. Alex and I would turtle down, get our spray out, both cans, and spray them. Yeah.
Yeah, well, that's a very good point. Thank you. Thank you for sharing that. Yeah, I know, I just wanted to ask you since you've been through it. Okay. So that's all. Those are some great information. What a great story. I'm so glad it all ended okay for the two of you and for the bear. But yeah, very, very powerful story and lessons. And I hope people can learn from that. And unfortunately, we didn't get to hear you in person at Bear Day, but I'm glad we could still get this information out there. Mm-hmm. And I just wanted to mention to people as well that are watching, when we're talking about finding information before you go, another great resource is our website at wildsmart.ca, where we have a weekly bear report, trail warnings and closures, a video about how to use bear spray, lots of great information that we have there that hopefully people will be able to use.
Yeah.
But Mya, I just wanted to say thank you very much. Oh, there you go. Hi there.
So leave this guy at home.
Yeah. And you know what? One statement I have about that is people need to think about what are you capable of handling out on the trail when things go wrong? Because yes, like you said, you guys had your hands full, just the two of you. But if you're out hiking with your family and your pets, there's a lot of things to keep track of. And you've got to focus your attention on certain things. And yeah, sometimes it might be easier to just leave your pets at home. Exactly.
Yeah.
It doesn't mean you're not a pet lover. That just means, you know, you're thinking practically and maybe you won't be able to handle everyone together in case things go wrong.
Yeah. And you know what? A walk in the city is the same as a walk in the forest for this guy.
Yeah. Exactly. So, Mya, thank you very, very much for joining me today and for sharing your story. And I'll probably at some point ask some questions to the audience. And then so we may have to do a little follow-up interview or maybe we can just post some of the questions and answers. But Great. Thank you very much for joining me today. And good luck with the rest of the summer and stay safe and healthy.